cover a little overview of what I'm looking at today, just a bit of a backstory of where I come from in all of this, and then why leadership and why does it matter. I am going to mainly focus on the university sector because it's actually very difficult to get figures for Queensland public schools, which tells you something, doesn't it? And then I'm going to debunk some myths around gender leadership and gender equity in the education system. And as said, I apologise because it mainly will be around universities, but I'll make the link back to schools because I think there's some very obvious parallels. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about the theme for our conference, Reclaiming Feminism, Reimagining Leading. So just a bit of a backstory for me. I grew up in Victoria, but don't hold that against me. I'm now here in beautiful Queensland, and I love it. But I come from a very working class background, a single mum who brought us up as a factory worker. And I also come from, though it doesn't look like it, a very non-Anglo background. I did eventually become a deputy principal in a large rural secondary school in the most Anglo-Saxon part of Victoria, having grown up in the most multicultural part of Victoria. And so that got me interested in leadership and the kinds of conflicts, I guess, and contestation around leadership when you're the youngest female deputy principal in this kind of extremely patriarchal rural area. And that's when I started a PhD with Jill Blackmore. So that was a wonderful experience. Okay, I'm just going to start with some quotes here from my PhD, which was now 9 years ago. But I looked at women who held senior leadership positions in universities, but who came from very different ethnic and class backgrounds. So I was really trying to trouble this notion of leadership as a white practice and a white male practice. And this was a comment from Simone, who was a very senior woman and has gone on to great stellar heights overseas. And this was her comment around how she felt as a senior woman administrator in universities. This is a comment from Amelia, who was a very senior. You couldn't get more senior than she was. And she was Aboriginal and a very strong feminist. And this was her comment about being a woman leader in universities and an Aboriginal woman. I love it because there's such relish in her voice. And there was great relish. She just loved challenging the system. And she gave the most wonderful interview about how she'd gone into this particular university, which was extremely racist and sexist, and looked around at all the men, because it was mainly men, on this particular extremely senior university committee, and said, in 12 months' time, most of you won't be here. And of course they went, and she was right, they weren't. So she was quite an extraordinary woman. And then this was a comment from a woman, again, a senior administrator. Now she was white, she was Anglo-Saxon, she was English background, but she was female and she came from a very working class background. And this was her comment about the battles she'd experienced. Now the reason I'm putting these quotes up is because I want to make a point about leadership and women in leadership. Because one of the issues for me has always been, and it's began with a PhD and my own background, is that leadership isn't just around what men do or what individual men do, it's also around white masculinist practices and how they keep getting reproduced in particular ways. And I think as women and feminists, we also need to be thinking about what this means for women and leadership in terms of particular ways of leading and leading practices, but also around that intersection between gender, our ethnicity, our class background, religion, etc. And so what I think is interesting in the first two quotes is that you have two women, an Aboriginal woman and a woman from a non-English speaking background, in inverted commas, who when they're talking about the issues they're facing around leadership is around what's getting foregrounded is their gender and their ethnicity. They're foregrounding that. These two things are combining in ways that are really problematic for them in the university space. For Lauren, what you see is it's her gender that's coming out as the issue. I asked her about being a white woman. Did this privilege you? And she said, I never thought about that. And then she talked a bit about that. But for her, the issue was being female It was also her class background. She deliberately kept a very working class English accent that she'd brought up with, and she got a lot of flack because of it, because of the way people looked down at her because of her class background. So it's how these different sort of social categories combine that make this, you know, much more complex, I think, than sometimes I think the leadership literature when it comes to women gives sort of, you know, voice to. And so for me, why leadership? Well, I see leadership as a lens through which to understand the sort of raced, ongoing gendered, raced and class social relations of power in organisations such as schools and universities. White men in suits, that's what I call them. And I don't see leadership as an individual practice. I think we need to reframe it and think about leadership as a socially situated practice. It's shaped and embodied in the sites of social practice that are organisations such and workplaces such as the globalised university and increasingly the globalised schooling system. So what are some of the myths of equity work in Australian universities? And I would say that these also apply to schools. So why should we bother as school people, educators and universities with gender equity work? Since there seems to be prevailing sentiment amongst some members of our media, politicians and perhaps the general public, that there's not a problem anymore when it comes to representation of women in education. We've heard some statistics from Dale Spender earlier on about that. So in our comparative study of equity policies and practices in Australia and New Zealand, my co-author Tony Fitzgerald and I did a study of New Zealand and Australian unis. And we said that there was a numerical mirage that we were witnessing that's happening in terms of gender equity in both our countries. And this mirage operates by suggesting there's a new feminisation of higher education. We're hearing that about schools too, a feminisation of schools that has secured a level of advantage for women. Women are advantaged now. And I love how the way feminisation gets used as if it's a pathology or some sort of disease that people are, you know, going about. We don't ever hear about a problem with the masculinisation of engineering or IT from the guys, but anyway. And so they use numerical data to secure this myth. They point to the fact that, and Dale's talked about it, female students now make up more than 50% of enrolments in universities across Australia. Women are located in the academic hierarchy as professors, deans, etc. And yes, that gives us a sense of our achievements, but it's highly problematic. And one of the reasons it's problematic is because the data's not being interrogated to think about things like familial status, ethnicity, social circumstances, sexuality, religion, factors that do impact on women in the workplace. So the reality is there are more females than males enrolling in university degrees. This disguises the fact that females are still predominantly studying in traditional gendered areas such as education and the social sciences, the so-called soft sciences rather than hard sciences. I'm not saying it's a problem, I'm a pre-humanities background, but it's concealing those sorts of disparities. Now, women are often in areas that pay a lot less than engineering and IT, where women remain underrepresented. It also conceals the fact that Australia still has a highly gendered, segregated labour market, with women continuing to enter a different labour market from males. And so women are severely underrepresented in a range of sectors. We hear all about the skill shortage. Do we ever hear about why aren't girls still going into plumbing, welding, carpentry, mechanics? So the choice for girls to enrol at university may in fact be concealing an ugly truth about the gender disparities in our labour market. If boys are leaving at the end of year 10, they're often going into apprenticeships or year 11. If they're not going on to uni, they're often going into very well-paid jobs. So we need to think about that. When we consider where women are located in universities, there seems to be this increasing sort of divide occurring between the women going into these more and more feminised management trajectories and the guys are moving and very much in research roles, research professors, etc. And guess which have more prestige, the management or the research side? It's the research. So women are tending to be concentrated in these kind of caring roles that require a lot of emotional labour, or soft skills of managing, so caring for students as managers of student services, equity, head of school, etc. For areas that require a high degree of organisational housekeeping, like quality management roles. So looking at this sort of data, that is what roles the genders are performing in, which disciplines and units they're located, provides demographically different pictures to emerge that can be theorised in terms of women's participation in the workforce. I'm just going to flip to the next slide because I can't even remember what the next slide was. That's it. Okay, so despite the numerical increase of women in the academy, the participation remains deeply marked by inequality due to what's called horizontal and vertical segregation. So there seems to be these surface indicators of increases of women in universities and an apparition of equality. But what are they suggesting about the direction of women in universities? Before we do that, let's have a little look at the Queensland public education sector. And thank you to the Queensland Teachers Union, who still have a women's officer, and I rang them up and they were able to get me these figures. So thank you to Madonna, who got these figures for me. Okay, so the myth of advantage. Percentage of female teachers employed, 76%. Ooh, feminisation happening, how shocking is that? Percentage of male teachers employed, 24%. We need more men in schools, we hear. That's a cry. Well, one of the reasons we don't have more male teachers is, gee, what's happening? They're all becoming principals very quickly. More than 3 out of 4 teachers are female. We have 602 female principals and 648 male. So there are 2/3 less women working as principals compared to males in 2014.
Sorry, could I just... I'm from New South Wales and the PEP union there too. Yep. And when you look at the female principals, they're largely in the very small schools in the lower grades, so it's not anywhere near...
Indeed. And the other thing, and it's an excellent point, so it's a question of, and where are these women working? And they're also in the tough schools, often the schools that are the most disadvantaged, really, really tough schools. But who's the head of Brisbane High School? I like the guy. It's a guy. So where are these women being located? In universities, it looks pretty good. Okay, they make up now 54.7% of the academic labour force, so that's very healthy. Where are they located, however, and who's doing what kinds of work? Okay, so we've got women being concentrated in greater numbers in medicine and health, and that's because of nursing in particular, humanities, arts and social sciences. But in science, there are 23% of women academics compared to males. Okay. This is based on a report called Work and Careers in Australian Universities. There are large numbers of women amongst sessional teaching staff, 57% compared to 43%. Almost half of academic staff are on fixed-term contracts. Women are more likely than men to be the main person responsible for caring for dependent children, and this difference is greater amongst sessional teaching staff. 63% of women, 10% of men, compared to academic staff. Almost 3/4 of staff, now I think anyone in schools as well as universities can relate to this one, almost 3/4 of staff, 78% of women and 67% of men felt they were almost always or often rushed or pressed for time, which is higher than recent findings from a general population study. Finally, women are less likely to reach senior management positions, with the proportion of senior lecturers now being the same. So so there's been a creep up, so we can have equity between the two. But at professorial level, men predominate. At level D, which is the associate professor, the sector average is 32%, and males make up the vast majority, obviously. And at level E, professor, the sector average is 22.93%. And if you actually look at the so-called sandstone, the research intensive universities, these figures are much worse, much, much worse. Okay, so it's much tougher. So the women attending, again, if their path into professorship is happening, it's going often through management, not through research. Okay, so one of the points we want to make about this kind of these figures is that they both reveal and conceal. So it's an interesting way in which this sort of data gets used. The figures don't reveal factors such as race, ethnicity, ability, disability, social class, although they do provide a crucial glimpse into caregiving responsibilities. The danger with figures on their own, when they're just taken on their own, is they contribute to a normalising portrayal of women in higher education and in schools, that all women are the same or similar. But to illustrate the differences between women, Indigenous women are now enrolling at twice the rate of men. They make up 67% of Indigenous staff in universities. as students, Indigenous women are much more likely to be mature-aged compared to non-Indigenous students. They're also more likely to have dependents. A staff Indigenous women are more likely to be at the top of the increment table and stay there for years. And also, despite the heavily feminised Indigenous workforce, of the 6 top-level Indigenous positions within the sector, 2 of them only are filled by women. For Indigenous staff, their community responsibilities extends into the workplace, and this brings with it additional levels of pressure compared to non-Indigenous staff.
Jenny, how am I going with time here? You've got 9 minutes.
Thank you, Marty. Okay, great. Okay, another little myth that we'd just like to explode is what we're calling the representational myth. And Jill Blackmore hinted at this when she talked right at the end about leadership being seen as a carefree. Academic women as caregivers, carefree or careless. Wouldn't we love that? So, in terms of women in academia, based on these figures and the ones I've cited above, equality for women, if you just look at it in numerical terms, is still a long way up. However, another area that we also argue is critical to unpack when it comes to understanding the position of women in academia, but also in other areas, is to think about what are the dominant discourses about women being in schools, being in academia. And one of them, it's very, very sort of classic, is this sort of notion of women as caregivers versus women as sort of carefree or careless. And I'll talk a little bit about this. As some of us may have painfully learned, I think many of us, from watching how Julia Gillard was represented in the traditional and social media, greater visibility of women in political life does not necessarily equate to equality. So I want to just finish by looking at some findings from some work I did examining the equal employment opportunity policies of 8 Australian universities. Now these policies, four of them, the universities were the Sandstone Research Intensive Universities, and 4 were taken from the so-called Muir Universities. And these policies have been really crucial instruments in driving the gender agenda forward in Australian universities. In fact, it's interesting, a recent study of new women professors in Australia actually identified a causal link between EEO initiatives and programs in a variety of universities and their appointment to the professoriate as one of 2 important catalysts to success. So they actually said these programs and these policies were incredibly important for us as women and getting to professoriate level. And the reason I'm looking at equal employment opportunity policies is because they and their accompanying programs are mandatory right at this moment, but they won't be, in Australia for all organisations which employ more than 100 people. But it won't happen for much longer because Tony Rabbit has decided that's not going to happen. We couldn't possibly have that happening. So that's about to change, but anyway. Okay, so two of the findings in looking at these policies were first that women and other equity groups were consistently identified as separate and distinct categories within policies with no discussion of intersection between the different groups. And there was a very narrow range of subject locations for the women in the policies. So I'm just going to talk briefly about that. So in terms of the lack of intersectionality, I'll just give an example. So what you have in these policies typically is sort of dot points of particular groups of people who've been traditionally disadvantaged in employment due to discrimination. So you get the dot point, Indigenous Australians, people who speak the first language other than English, people with a disability, and women. And it's like, well, hang on a minute, aren't they all women and men belong here? But it's like they're all, you know, they're sort of completely separate categories. So the effect is a kind of shopping list of disadvantage, producing these parallel but seemingly disconnected streams of disadvantage through a set of binary oppositions, such as Indigenous Australians, people who speak a first language other than English. So using these kinds of frameworks, static categories, produces these dichotomies that instead of actually disrupting, may in fact be reinforcing particular notions of centre and margin inside and outside. The outsider. And so that can actually re-inscribe enduring systems of inequity rather than disrupting them. That's why I find it problematic. And what this can actually do is reproduce this sort of homogenising and essentialising view of women that doesn't reflect the very real differences within and between groups of women. And one of the dangers of flattening these differences out between women as a group is that privileges a kind of white middle class perspective of women's experiences and concerns as the kind of default subject position from which everything else is sort of taken. It privileges particular kinds of equity practice at the expense of other forms. And it reinforces women as the problem to be fixed, rather than raising questions about the privileging of particular kinds of white masculinities that are maintained within the academy. And that, you know, for me is absolutely fundamental. Two dominant forms of differentiation in terms of the subject locations for women in these policies were in relation to women's role as caregivers, and secondly, as senior or wanting to be members, senior members of the upper echelons of universities. But the two are never portrayed as interlinked, so they're always two distinctive categories, separate, commas, etc. Although one policy did note the need for recognition of different career patterns and flexibility in order to increase the pool of eligible female applicants at senior level. So the implications are kind of is that it's like you can either be a caregiver or you can aspire towards seniority, but not simultaneously. And these kinds of divisions implicitly sort of suggest that senior positions in universities are careless positions when it comes to these primary roles. And that privileges those who are carefree, disproportionately numbers of whom are male. And given the lack of representation of women at these more senior levels of academia, it suggests that's the two reasons for it. One is because of the way in which leading is being shown as something that is the province of people who are careless, who do not have these caring responsibilities, as well as directly discriminatory practices in appointments, promotions, and workloads. So it's those two things. Okay, so I just want to finish off by thinking about reclaiming feminism and engendering change. Maria's wonderful title for this conference, and I want to talk just very briefly about reimagining leading. Just in talking about these policies, what appeared to be absent from the discourses were more fundamental questions about which groups of women and males are currently privileged in gaining senior positions, and what's the nature of the work to which women as a group are being encouraged to aspire. Too often, debates about the lack of equality of women at senior levels in universities and schools are frequently constructed as an issue of women gaining this representational balance. You know, if we only get 76% of women at principal level, thank you, sorry Maria, it's probably really irritating you if that happened, sorry, then everything will be fine. So the myth is that equal numbers of females and males in leadership roles will lead to social equity, or there's an assumption that having more women leaders will automatically bring about social justice for equity groups, because women by their nature supposedly have access to these caring and sharing skills that the sector wants to take advantage of. But the question of whether women in academia raises bigger questions for unions as workplaces and for schools, I think, and for feminism as a movement. Because one of the things that's happened that's really disturbing our sector, and it's happened in schools, I have a niece who's in exactly this position, is the increasing casualisation of these sectors. So we've got two classes of academics, like we've got two classes of teachers. We've got the casuals, the majority of whom are women, and whose status is somewhat akin to domestic servants, and a core group of tenured academic staff. So the uncomfortable truth for us as women is that there are now greater disparities and differences between the sweatshop labour of female sessional workers on the one hand, and that of a high-ranking female associate professor on the other. I've been both. I started off as a sessional. So our class differences are now as great, if not greater, than what binds us together. And as has been noticed by a couple of great feminists, Metcalfe and Slaughter, if women are numerically equal in salary and positions, but the academic capitalist knowledge learning regime persists, in what's been gained. So, just to finish, I talk here about from leadership to leading. So to think about leading leadership is kind of, gives a sense of a kind of fixed entity or property, but to think more perhaps around leading as a dynamic and socially situated constructive practice, but also to start thinking about reimagining leading as a collective and a site-based practice underpinned by a democratic and a socially just telos or aim. And I think that's perhaps a nice note to be.